Good morning and welcome to the 33rd meeting in 2015 of the Health and Sport Committee. I would ask everyone in the room to switch off mobile phones as they can often interfere with the sound system, but also ask people to note that you will see many of us around the table using tablet devices, which are instead of our hard copies of our papers. We have received apologies from Bob Doris and Michael Russell, substitute member, is enjoying us in his place. Welcome, Mike. Mr. Russell's first appearance as a substitute member, and I would ask him to declare any relevant interests.
Yeah, the only one I can think of is I'm a part-time professor in governance at the University of Glasgow.
Thank you, Mike. We proceed then quickly to the first item on our agenda today, which is stage two, day two, consideration of the Carers Scotland Bill. Minister, you've got your same team with you today, I see. So we'll move right on then to our business as continuation from last week, and I call amendment. Oh yes, sorry, we have in my anxious nature to get through all of these things. I need to ask you first of all if you agree that we take business in private, and that would be agenda item number five, which is to is about our approach paper to access newly licensed medicines. So we have agreed that we'd you'd do that. So can I have that agreement? Thank you. Now we will move, Minister, to call amendment 25 in the Minister's name, grouped with other amendments as shown in the groupings. Can I ask the Minister to move amendment 25 and speak to all amendments in the group?
Thank you very much, Convener. I'd like to introduce this group of amendments to the committee which concern responsibility for the preparation of the local carer strategy. Health boards have a vital role in identifying and supporting carers, and I agree with the Health and Sport Committee's recommendation that the Carers Bill should complement the new integrated health and social care arrangements. To that end, provision will be made so that all functions under the bill which relate to delivery of services to adult carers will require to be delegated under integration schemes under the Public Bodies Act 2014. For young carers, all functions are capable of being delegated to the local authority and health board. To further recognise the key role of health boards in identifying and supporting carers, I brought forward Amendment 25. This amends Section 28(1) of the Bill so that the duty on local authorities to prepare a local carer strategy for each local authority area will be jointly on the local authority and the relevant health board. As a result of this key amendment, there are a number of amendments which follow on from this. Amendment 47 amends Section 28(5) to set out the definition of relevant health board in relation to a local authority. Amendments 48 and 49 place the existing duty on local authorities to have regard to the factors set out at Section 29(8)(e) in preparing a local care strategy makes this a joint duty on local authorities and health boards. Amendments 50 to 57 are also consequential to Amendment 25, modifying Section 30 on publication and review of the local care strategy so that the duties on local authorities set out in this section are placed jointly on the local authority and relevant health board. I move Amendment 25 and ask that members support the rest of the consequential amendments in this group.
Thank you. No members have indicated they wish to speak. I don't suppose you have anything to add, Minister?
Indeed not. Convener.
Thank you. Then the question is that Amendment 25 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I now call Amendments 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37 and 38, all in the name of the Minister. Previously debated, can I invite the Minister to move 26 to 38 on block?
Moved on block, Convener.
Ask whether, has any member object to a single question we put on amendments 26 to 38? No objection. The question is then that amendments 26 to 30 are agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We now call amendment 82 in the name of Rhoda Grant, grouped with amendments 104, 105 and 106. with the grant to move Amendment 82 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Can I move Amendment 82 and speak to the others in the group? These amendments concern the local carer strategy. Amendment 82 ensures that the strategy looks at preventative support in order to decrease the number of carers who break down in their role. A good preventative strategy will also cut down the number of people who require an assessment. It's really important that we value the work carers do and support them to continue, and the carer strategy must deal with this. Amendments 104, 105 and 106 deal with equality issues and ensure that the strategy takes into account protected characteristics and how people in these groups can be supported in their caring role. The situation they find themselves in can, and indeed their ability to access services, can be affected by language, culture and relationships. And it's important that the strategy recognises these differences and makes sure that services are person-centred and delivered in a way that's accessible to all of those who need them.
Thank you. No other members have indicated they wish to speak, Minister.
Convener, can I thank Ms Grant for bringing forward these amendments? I see the preventative approach as being very important, as set out in the policy memorandum that accompanied this bill. It's one of the key principles underpinning this legislation. The bill contains provisions which aim to support and promote such an approach. For example, as I mentioned at last week's session with the committee, we have removed the regular and substantial test for someone to be recognised as a carer so that all carers will have access to an adult care support plan or a young carer statement, enabling people to request an adult care support plan or young carer statement as soon as they become a carer, offering one to adult carers and young carers as soon as they're identified should mean that the plan can be put in place at an early stage. This should reduce the need to deal with crisis situations. Less critical needs for support will also be considered as part of the adult carer support plan or young carer statement process. Nonetheless, prevention is important, and I can see there could be merit in the local carer strategy setting out plans for supporting carers on a preventative basis, which is the main thrust of Ms Grant's Amendment 82. I think we need to consider that amendment further. But as it stands, there are questions about whether it would be possible under the bill for a local authority to reduce a carer's needs for support once they have arisen, indeed other than by providing them with support. There is potentially a compliability issue here with the way the bill is drafted, and on that basis I would ask Ms Grant to consider withdrawing Amendment 82 on the basis that we can discuss the matter further and bring forward an amendment at stage 3 that seeks to achieve the aim of a local carer strategy setting out preventive planning but with no unintended consequences. I also consider it important to me that the provisions set out the carers bill meet the needs of carers with one or more protected characteristics. However, I believe that amendments 104, 105 and 106 are not required to achieve this aim. Local authorities and health boards are already under a general public sector equality duty under the Equality Act 2010, duplicating an existing legal duty is unnecessary and wasteful of compliance resources within local authorities. To the extent that Amendment 104 might ask more than the current Section 149 duty in the Equality Act 2010, it could be potentially give rise to legislative competence concerns. If compliance needs to be addressed, there are existing powers in the Equality Act, powers to do that. As the statutory duty exists already, I therefore ask Ms Grant not to move Amendments 104, 105 and 106, but to meet with me to discuss Amendment 82 further.
Rhoda Grant, to wind up, press or withdraw.
I'm happy to meet with the Minister to discuss Amendment 82 and we'll withdraw that pending those discussions. I'm concerned that he doesn't see the need for 104, 105 and 106. I think this is one, certainly in committee, we took evidence on, and it was quite clear that if this isn't in the face of the bill, that sometimes those issues are overlooked in drawing up the strategy. I've listened to what the Minister said. I don't believe he is willing to have further discussions on this, so I'll maybe move those.
Yeah,
when the time comes. We'll,
yeah. Thanks. The member has withdrawn the amendment. Do any members object?
No.
Thank you. I now call Amendment 104 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with Amendment 82. Rhoda Grant, to move or not move?
Move.
Move. The question is then, Amendment 104 be agreed to?
Yes.
Are we all agreed?
Yes.
No.
We're not agreed, there'll be a division. All those in favour of the amendment, please show. 1, 2, 3, 4, good. All those against the amendment? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I now call Amendment 83 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with Amendment 70. Rhoda Grant, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Does any other member? No. Wish to move? No. We now move to call Amendment 39 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 25. Minister, to move formally?
It moved, Convener.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 39 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I now call Amendments 40, 41 and 42, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. Can I invite the Minister to move Amendments 40 to 42 in block?
It moved on block, Convener.
Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 40 to 42?
No.
No, thank you. The question is then that Amendments 40 to 42 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Thanks. I now call Amendment 84 in the name of Rhoda Grant. Group with Amendment 85, Rhoda Grant, to move Amendment 84 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Can I move Amendment 84 and speak to both? This amendment ensures that colleges and universities are consulted during the development of carer strategies. Schools are already included in the bill as part of the local authority, but young carers are also concerned about the support they receive from colleges and universities. These amendments will ensure that colleges and universities look at how they support carers, allowing them to access further and higher education.
Thank you. Is there no other member wishing to speak? Minister?
Thank you, Convener. I'm not entirely clear that Amendments 84 and 85 are necessary on the face of the bill. They seem to be seek to ensure that the needs of young carers approaching the transition to adult carers are taken into account when preparing the local carer strategy. But the bill already contains provisions to this effect. The provision at section 28.4a provides that local authorities and health boards must involve whichever other bodies representative of carers they consider appropriate in the preparation of their local carer strategy, and 28.4b provides that they must take such steps as they consider appropriate to involve carers. This list is not exclusive if a local authority and health board believe that it's necessary to consult any educational bodies in that area, then they can choose to do so. I'm not convinced that it's necessary to legislate for this, and on that basis would ask the member to withdraw Amendment 84 and not move Amendment 85.
Thank you, Minister. Rhoda Grant, to wind up, press withdrawal.
I don't think colleges and universities would be seen as groups representing carers. I think there's a real issue about young people accessing education. We have issues in schools, which I think the bill will deal with, but we have issues in colleges and universities as well. We see that young carers are often penalised because they don't attend as often as they should, and they don't get the support they should quite often from colleges and universities. I believe that the bill requires this amendment, so I will move 84.
The question is then, Amendment 84 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not. We have a division. All those in favour of the Amendment 84, please show. 84. All those against the amendment? The amendment is therefore not agreed. I now move to call Amendment 43, 44. 45 and 46, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move Amendments 43 to 46 on block.
It moved on block, Convener.
Thank you. Do any members object to the single question being put to Amendments 43 46? No. The question is then that Amendments 43 to 46 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. I now move to call Amendment 105 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with Amendment 82. Rhoda Grant, to move or not move?
Not
move. Not move. Do any other members wish to move the amendment?
No.
No, thank you. We now move to call Amendment 47 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 25. Minister, to move forward.
Moved, Convener.
Thank you. The question is then that Amendment 47 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Thanks. I now call Amendment 85 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with Amendment 84. Rhoda Grant, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Members not moving. Any other member wish to move?
No.
I call Amendment 106 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with Amendment 82.
Not moved.
Members not moving. Any other member wish to move?
No.
The question is that Section 28 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah, agreed.
Thank you. I now call Amendment 48 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 25. Minister, to move formally.
It moved, Convener.
Thank you. The question is then that Amendment 48 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thanks. I now call Amendment 49 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 25. Minister, to move formally.
Moved, Convener.
Thank you. The question is then that Amendment 49 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. The question is then that Section 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thanks. I now call Amendments 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56 and 57. All in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move Amendments 50 to 57 on block. Ask... Yes, Minister.
I've looked for your
agreement to move on block. Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 50 to 57?
No.
The question is then Amendments 50 to 57 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. The question is then that Section 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I now call Amendment 58 in the name of the Minister in a group on its own. Minister, to move and speak to Amendment 58.
Thank you, Convener. Third sector organisations and carers have raised concerns that the bill as currently drafted may be interpreted as imposing a requirement on local authorities to establish a new information advice service where such a service or part of the service is already provided by organisations other than the local authority. Convener, you will recall this was, of course, an issue picked up on by your committee during its consideration of the bill at stage one. Amendment 58 proposes additional wording to section 31(1) to clarify the policy intention. Although local authorities will have a duty to establish and maintain an information advice service, it is not envisaged that this duty requires that local authorities should themselves provide all and every aspect of the information and advice that is required under section 31(2) to be available. Rather, it is expected that local authorities will understand, coordinate, make effective use of other statutory or voluntary and independent sector sources which can and do provide information and advice that are available to carers within their respective areas. I want the existing information and advice which is provided so expertly by organisations such as carers centres and young carers projects and by health boards to remain. In establishing and maintaining an information and advice service or ensuring the establishment and maintenance of such service, I would expect each local authority to make the best possible use of what already exists. This amendment will make clear that where sources of information and advice for carers are already available within the local authority area, there is no requirement to create any additional information and advice service. This will be made further clear in the guidance that will be issued to local authorities about information and advice services as well, Convener, and I move Amendment 58.
Thank you. No member has indicated that they wish to speak. I presume that the Minister does not wish to add anything.
Indeed not, Convener.
Okay. The question is then that Amendment 58 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I now call Amendment 59 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 4. Minister, to move forward.
It moved, Convener.
Thank you. The question is then that Amendment 59 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I now call Amendment 86 in the name of Rhoda Grant, grouped with Amendment 88. Rhoda Grant, to move Amendment 86 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Can I move 86 and speak to both? Amendment 88 legislates for the carers' charter, and I'm aware that there is work ongoing to draw up a charter between carers' groups. And carers' groups are also keen to see this enshrined in legislation. So amendment doesn't prescribe what the charter is, but it does ensure that carers are involved in drawing it up. It's important that when the charter is in place that carers are aware of it and the rights it enshrines. Hence, Amendment 86 places a duty on advice and information services to make carers aware of the charter and its content.
Thank you. No other members indicated they wish to speak. Minister?
Thank you, Convener. As Ms Grant alludes to, carers' rights charter is not a new concept, and as she also mentions, a carers' rights charter is under development. It has been somewhat delayed. The charter arose out of the carer strategy and was intended for adult carers only. Although not required by the carer strategy, we commissioned separate work for a young carers charter. That work is also ongoing, and we expect to receive the latest draft of a young carers rights charter later this month from the Scottish Young Carers Services Alliance. The current charter in development includes the expectations what carers can expect derived from guidance, as well as consolidating existing rights. The charter envisaged by Amendment 80 is a bit narrow in scope in the charter we are preparing. It is not, in my view, necessarily a burning requirement to have the charter set out in legislation. However, I'm happy to support Ms Grant's amendments today, but in doing so, I indicate they will require some finessing at stage three. Let me indicate to the committee some of the areas that may require further amendment at that stage. Looking at Amendment 88, any other enactment would include UK legislation, but which the Scottish Government may not be in the best position to provide up-to-date information. It's also important to be clear that the Charter is where rights that have been conferred elsewhere are collated and set out in one place and should not create new rights of itself. This is because there wouldn't be a proper parliamentary scrutiny where any future government seeks to bring forward new rights for carers. If that was the case, it would not be right to establish new rights in such a document on that basis. Having set out the key areas that will require some attention, further attention at stage three, let me reiterate, I'm happy to support Rhoda Grant's amendments today that seek to put a carers' rights charter in statute.
Rhoda Grant, to wind up, press or withdraw?
I'll just press. quit while I'm ahead.
Quit while you're ahead. The question is then that Amendment 86 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We now move to call Amendment 60 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 6. Minister, to move forward.
Move, Convener.
Thank you. The question is then that Amendment 60 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thanks. I now call Amendment 87 in the name of Rhoda Grant and a group on its own. Rhoda Grant to move and speak to Amendment 87.
Can I move Amendment 87? This amendment places a duty on advice and information services to make carers aware of bereavement support. Too often carers feel abandoned at bereavement. They're often given little time to find their feet and adapt to their new circumstances. And there can be quite intensive intervention in the final days of life, and a carer will be used to having people in and out of the house, and then suddenly that all stops with bereavement and people can become very isolated. Carers have also quite often given up work, neglected friendships in order to carry out their caring role, and therefore they need to be supported through the transition.
Thanks. Nanette Millen.
Convener, I'm supporting Rhoda Grant with this amendment. I mean, I know and I hear from Marie Curie that, in fact, a significant number of people do, in fact, feel totally bereft, apart from their proper bereavement, once the person they're caring for has died. And I think it is very, very important to look after these people at a time of pretty great need for them.
Okay. Minister.
You, Convener, as Nanette Milne has just said, I too recognise it can be difficult, even devastating, when the a carer's caring role comes to an end. I'm aware that some local carer centres continue to support carers after their caring role ends. A number of members spoke about this during the Stage 1 debate. There is a provision which can provide support for carers when their caring role ends. Bereavement care is provided across Scotland to relatives and carers following a death in ways that are responsive to their needs and which reflect spiritual, religious and cultural requirements. When someone has died, information pact has been developed to help people through the first few days of a bereavement is widely used across the NHS in Scotland. The bereavement zone on the NHS Inform website offers a lot of practical advice after a death and coping with grief. Both offer specific advice for children or young people, which young carers may find particularly helpful. Information on how to access these local services can be found on the NHS Board website or directly from NHS staff. National services such as Breathing Space and Crews Bereavement Care Scotland are available to those who need someone to talk to. The caring role may come to an end for a different reason other than the death of the cared for person. The cared for person may, for instance, have been admitted to a care home. This situation may be very difficult for the carer. The bill is focused on providing access to support to carers in order to sustain their caring role. The person-centred outcomes approach will ensure that carers are supported at the right time. As part of this, it will be critical that outcomes are reviewed to ensure the continued relevance of support and services for carers. This is important when carers are caring for someone coming to the end of their life. The information advice service provided by each local authority must provide information and advice about health and wellbeing, including counselling services for carers. We would envisage that counselling might include bereavement counselling. Despite the good range of services that exist, I recognise that carers might have particular issues and challenges, such as coming to terms with not having a caring role for a loved one or trying to get back into work after not being in employment. Rhoda Grant's amendment is, however, very wide in scope, as it looks as if it covers information, advice and bereavement support for carers when people other than the cared-for person dies. I don't think that's necessarily the intention here, and I would like to work with Rhoda Grant so she may bring forward an alternative amendment at stage 3, and on that basis I therefore ask her to withdraw Amendment 87, and it can be a matter we can discuss so we can get it right for stage 3.
Rhoda Grant, wind up, pressure, withdraw.
I think it's really important that carers get bereavement support, and indeed that it should maybe form part of their assessment how they will be supported when their caring role ends. But I take on board what the Minister has said about the breadth of the amendment. I wouldn't want it to be that wide. I would want it to be when somebody's caring role ends. And with that in mind, I will have further discussions with the Minister and bring forward an amendment at stage 3.
Member withdraws the amendment. Thank you. Any other member object?
No.
No. Okay. Can I now move to call Amendment 61 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 4. Minister, to move formally.
Move, Convener.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 61 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 31 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Question is then that Section 32 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thanks. I now call Amendment 88 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with Amendment 86. Rhoda Grant, to move or not move?
Move.
Move. The question is then that Amendment 88 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I now move to call Amendment 107 in the name of Rhoda Grant and a group on its own. Rhoda Grant, to move and speak to Amendment 107.
Can I move Amendment 107? This amendment ensures that the NHS identifies carers and ensures that their health needs are attended to. Often carers, especially young carers, see GPs and healthcare staff coming and going from their home, but they're never asked how they're coping and if they're getting the support they require. NHS staff are ideally placed to identify carers of every age and refer them to support services. There are instances when this happens and it has proved a godsend for the carers involved. However, often it doesn't happen and carers feel abandoned and ignored without help or support.
So other members have indicated they wish to speak. Minister?
Thank you very much. Convener, I understand and fully appreciate the need to promote carers' health and wellbeing, and indeed all the provisions in the carers' bill are designed to ensure that carers can continue to care if they wish to do so in good health. The identification of carers' personal outcomes within the context of the Adult Carer Support Plan and Young Carer Statement is central to this. Also, the focus of the specific integration national health and wellbeing outcome relating to carers is that carers are supported to look after their own health and wellbeing, including to reduce any negative impact of their caring role on their own health and wellbeing. I would like to take a little time to mention here the new way forward for the GP contract is relevant to supporting carers. The Scottish Government has set a direction of travel around the future arrangements for the GP contract in Scotland. This is designed to reduce bureaucracy and to free up GP time for face-to-face contact with patients. We'll be moving towards a more integrated GP contract that supports the role of the GP in the wider community. As I've said, the whole purpose of the bill is to support carers' health and well-being. The new way ahead for the GP contract will enable GPs to have more contact with carers, which will enable carers to ask for health checks where appropriate. Carers can also be encouraged through the Adult Carer Support Plan and Young Carer Statement to visit their GP to maintain their own health and well-being. The National Review of Out-of-Hours Primary Care Services, led by Sir Lewis Ritchie, which reported yesterday, recommends a multidisciplinary team-based approach for the delivery of urgent care services. This proposed new model of care will help to mitigate against issues such as recruitment and retention of GPs. It will also encourage health and social care staff to work better together. This person-centred and joined-up approach will help to improve the management of staff availability, especially during peak holiday times, consistency of service and the public's expectation of the service. All of these crucial wider developments will support carers' health and well-being. In future arrangements, GPs will have a focus in supporting the planning of services locally through clusters of GP practices coming together to plan and develop services for the local community. The work to develop and support GP clusters will be a key strand of work for the Health and Social Care Partnerships Integration Joint Boards. Crucially, carers are to be represented on the integration joint boards and can, with GPs, influence the work to plan and develop GP services for the local community. The new direction of travel for GPs will free up GP time to deal with patients with complex needs, including time to support their carers. I propose to write to NHS boards to encourage them to continue to identify carers and support them in health settings. These health settings include GP practices, but other health settings such as hospitals and community pharmacists are just as important in supporting carers' health and well-being. On carer identification more generally, there are a number of provisions in the bill to support this. A key one is that each local authority and relevant health board must prepare a local carer strategy, setting out their plans for identifying carers in its area and obtaining information about the care they provide or intend to provide. This will support carer identification by GPs. In light of all this that I've set out, I would ask the member not to move Amendment 107.
No other members indicated. No. Rhoda Grant, wind up, press or withdraw.
While I welcome everything the Minister said, and those are small changes, there is a culture out there that doesn't recognise carers, and that's, I mean, there's a culture out there where some carers don't recognise themselves as carers and indeed don't ask for help because they are so taken up with their caring role that they feel they need to continue. Health professionals are in a great place to identify carers, but often do not. I myself wrote some years ago now to GPs asking how many young carers they had in their practice. I was surprised at the number of responses that came back saying none, when we know about 25% of young people are young carers. I don't think that has changed hugely between then and now, and therefore I propose to move this amendment because I think it's really important we make it a duty on everybody to identify and support young carers, especially those that are best placed to identify them.
Okay. The question is then that Amendment 107 be agreed to. Are we all agree?
No.
We have a division. For all those in favour of Amendment 107, please show. All those against? 5. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The question then is that Section 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 62 in the name of the Minister and a group on its own. Minister, to move and speak to Amendment 62.
Thank you, Convener. Section 33 of the Bill, as introduced, confers powers on Scottish Ministers to issue guidance to local authorities in respect of their functions under the Carers Bill. It also allows Scottish Ministers to issue directions to local authorities as to the manner in which they are to exercise their functions. There is currently no equivalent provision in relation to the functions conferred by the Bill on health boards and on directing authorities of schools. Amendment 62 will address this. It will allow Scottish Ministers to issue guidance and directions to health boards and directing authorities in respect of their functions under the Bill. For example, in respect of the preparation of young carer statements by health boards for young carers where they are preschool children. This provision will require health boards and directing authorities to have regard to any such guidance and directions when performing their functions under the bill, and I move Amendment 62.
No member has indicated they wish to speak. I don't believe you need to add in further
Indeed
minister.
Not,
can we not? Okay, the question is then that Amendment 62 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that section 34 and 35 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Call Amendment 63 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 4. Minister, to move formally.
It moved, Convener.
Thank you. Question is then that Amendment 63 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
I now call Amendment 64 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 70. Minister, to move formally.
Move, Convener.
Thank you. Question is then that Amendment 64 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah,
I now call Amendment 89 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with Amendment 70. Rhoda Grant, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. Members not moving. Does any other member wish to move?
No.
No, thank you. The question is then that Section 36 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Thanks. I now call Amendment 65 in the name of the Minister and a group on its own. Minister, to move and speak to Amendment 65.
Thank you, Convener. The power at Section 1.3 and the regulations made under it are intended to give effect to the policy that kinship care arrangements under the Looked After Children Scotland Regulations 2009 are not to be regarded as contracts under this bill, and to put beyond doubt that similar agreements that exist between foster carers and local authorities are to be regarded as contracts for the purposes of the bill. Section 1.3b is also intended to make provision for those people who in policy terms are referred to as mixed carers. Mixed carers are carers who undertake both unpaid care and paid care for the same family member. In the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee letter to the Scottish Government on the 31st of March 2015, the committee asked for further justification as to the choice of the negative procedure for the exercise of the power in Section 1.3 and why the affirmative procedure was not considered to be more appropriate for this power. I've considered the committee's concern that the power in Section 1.3 could potentially expand or restrict the reach of the bill's provisions on providing support to carers depending on the manner in which it is exercised. It's certainly the case that unpaid caring is a complex area which could become more so in the future. It's possible, for example, as the Social Care Act 2013, which is in the early stages of implementation, becomes more prevalent, further types of mixed care may emerge. In light of the committee's concerns, I have brought forward this amendment to make Section 1.3 power subject to affirmative procedure, and I move Amendment 65.
Thank you. No member wishes to speak. The question is then that Amendment 65 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thanks. Call Amendment 866. The name of the Minister already debated with Amendment 70. Minister, do you move formally?
Move, Convener.
Thank you. Question is then that Amendment 66 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thanks. Now call Amendment 67 in the name of the Minister already debated with Amendment 70. Minister, to move formally.
Move, Convener.
Thank you. The question is then that Amendment 67 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 90 in the name of Rhoda Grant already debated with Amendment 78. Rhoda Grant, to move or not move?
Not move.
Not move. Members not moving. Does any other member wish to move?
No.
Okay. We now move to call Amendment 68 in the name of the Minister already debated with Amendment 17. Minister, to move formally.
It moves, Convener.
Thank you. Question is then that Amendment 68 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Now call Amendment 91 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with Amendment 80. Rhoda Grant, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Members not moving. Any other member wish to move?
No.
No. Then we move to the question that Section 37 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Thank you. Question is that Sections 38 and 39 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Okay.
I call Amendment 69 in the name of the Minister, already debated, with Amendment 81. Minister, to move formally.
It moves, Convener.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 69 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Question is that the schedule be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Question is then that Sections 40 and 41 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That ends stage two consideration of the bill. Members should note that the bill will now be reprinted as amended. The Parliament has not yet determined when stage three of the bill will take place, but members can now lodge stage three amendments at any time. With the legislation team, members will be informed of the deadline for amendments once it has been determined. Suspend the committee at this point We now move to our second item on the agenda this morning, which is our third oral evidence session on the Transplantation, Authorisation, Removal of Organs, etc. Scotland Bill. Can I welcome Anne McTaggart, who is the member for the bill, who's joined us, and we'll have that opportunity at some point in the session to ask some questions. We have with us this morning Sally Johnson, Director of Organ Donation and Transplantation, NHS Blood and Transplant. Welcome. Liz Waite and Irene Young, Specialist Nurses in Organ Donation, NHS Blood and Transplant. Welcome. Professor Alison Britton, Convener of the Society's Health and Medical Law Committee, Law Society of Scotland, and Lorna Marson, Vice President of British Transplantation Society. Welcome to you all. We're not expecting any opening statements, so we'll go directly to questions. And our first question is from Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, ladies. Could I direct my question to Sally Johnson? I'm sure Irene Young and Liz Waite may wish to come in, but I'd welcome the other two witnesses to come in. In a recent visit to Spain, we found out that basically within the hospital in Madrid that we went to, there was a specialist doctor who basically dealt with, these were located within the hospital, and they dealt with the families. And basically it was put to us that that was one of the reasons why Spain's rates are superior to Great Britain's. What in your view, and I don't take away the work that you're doing and what you're doing in your everyday capacity, but what, in your view, would improve the rates in Great Britain? Would it be the case, similar to advocating what's happening in Spain, and could you please explain to us, just for the record, what exactly happens within the hospitals when, unfortunately, someone dies? We have, is it a case that the acute doctor speaks to the family after it and then the specialist nurses are brought in, or is it a case the specialist nurse comes in? I'd be interested to know what actually physically happens in the hospitals at this moment in time.
Okay, that's quite a wide-ranging question, so I'll endeavour to answer it, and I may call on my colleagues to give you a bit more discussion about what actually happens, because they're on the front line. But essentially, we have a very similar system to Spain in this country now, the difference being that we have a clinical lead for organ donation in every hospital in the UK, who is then supported by what we call an embedded specialist nurse. So that's somebody like Irene, who is dedicated to working with one or more hospitals, who will support the hospital development end of things so that there are policies and procedures in place to identify and refer organ donors when anyone can be an organ donor, and make sure that their family is approached after they've called in the specialist nurse. And the best practice would suggest, and is mostly followed, not always because these things are complicated, that the doctor would speak to the family and make sure that the family understand that their relative is either dead or irretrievably dying and unable to be helped. Once they've understood that, then normally the specialist nurse would come in and provide support in helping them to reach a decision about organ donation. So it's not radically different from Spain. It may be slightly different in that we run an on-call rota, so it's not always the same nurse in every hospital, but we provide a 24/7 service, and there is always a nurse available to go and talk to a family when required. So I think from that point of view, much of what has been done in Spain has also been done in the UK following the implementation of the Organ Donor Task Force recommendations. And that's why donor numbers in the UK have increased by over 60% in the last 6-7 years. I guess there are two things that's worth noting with regard to Spain. Their model of end-of-life care is very different from the UK. They have many more intensive care beds. And I think it's true to say that as a result, they have more people who die from brain death, who spend longer in hospital, and their families are approached for organ donation. We don't have as many potential donors as Spain appears to have, and that is why our numbers are lower in one respect. There is also the issue of consent. But I think that this is quite complicated. There are two ways in which you can die to become an organ donor. You can either be brain dead or brain stem dead, as you normally describe it. And those are people who are ventilated, you know, following a serious brain injury. And there is quite a lot of time with those patients normally to talk to the families. But there are limited numbers of patients who die in that way in the UK compared with Spain. As a consequence, we have developed a world-class donation after circulatory death service. So that's people who die in the way that we're all familiar with from watching people die on television, or at least actors die on television. And that is a slightly different prospect, because in those circumstances, this is somebody who is dying but for whom further treatment is futile. We approach the family and seek agreement to proceed with organ donation. And obviously, if they say yes, then we call a retrieval team, and the retrieval team has to wait for the person to die and then retrieve the organs. And not, you know, predicting death is extremely difficult. Don't always die within the timescale where their organs will be usable. And therefore, the number of people who go on to become actual donors from that pool of donors is much lower. So if we look at the consent rates in this country, I think our consent rates for donation after circulatory death are probably some of the best in the world. We have a very wide field of donors that we look at, but actually, you know, 50% or more is quite a good rate for that group of donors. We still have a lower rate of consent for donors after brain death, although it's rising, and the UK consent rate in October was 69.5%, which suggests that we are approaching world, you know, moving towards world-class levels. That was a donor rate of 26 per million population. So that's in line with where we're going with the UK-wide strategy and the Scottish plan for implementing that strategy too. So I think there's quite a lot of similarities in terms of the processes with compared with Spain, but there are some differences in terms of end-of-life care and the potential pool of donors. And people often don't realise that the pool of potential donors is tiny. It's only about 5,000 people across the UK who die in circumstances where they can become organ donors, even though over 500,000 people die each year. And so that's part of our challenge.
Anyone else? No, not at this point.
Can I ask further? One of the things that actually struck me on the visit to Spain was the percentage of expats, that British residents in Spain, they donate their organs at a higher rate than what there is in Great Britain. Is it a case that we don't, this sounds very, encourage people to, or educate people to say that, organs can go on to save someone's life. In my last couple of years, my mother-in-law and father-in-law died, unfortunately. No one approached us at the time to ask for, whether we wish to, and I didn't think about it at that time, to be quite honest with you. Only this bill has made me think about it. So do we actually physically, with the greatest respect when I say this, approach families on a basis, as and when, to ask them, will you donate your organs to save someone else's life? Because at the end of the day, it could possibly do so.
I'm pretty confident that in about 90% of cases in Scotland, if someone can be a donor after brain death, that potential will be identified and referred to our service. It is lower in respect of donation after circulatory death, and that's a more complicated situation to recognise that donation is possible. I suspect that the reason that you were not approached was because your parents, your relatives were not able to be donors, and we don't approach people where they're not able to be donors. In terms of education, I think Scotland has had a long and very excellent, sustained education programme in schools. You've had excellent campaigns, which has increased the number of people on the organ donor register to over 40% in some parts of Scotland. Spain doesn't have an organ donor register, interestingly. They rely solely on family conversations. But from my understanding of the situation in Spain, that there's often more time. And it's very difficult, if people haven't thought about this issue previously, to get them to think about it and reach a conclusion that's positive if they're incredibly shocked, grieving, and this is coming to them absolutely new, which is why there's been such a focus on trying to get people to have a chat about organ donation while they're alive so that their family and friends know what they would want when they're dead. And what I think, you know, the reality is whatever system you have, it is always helpful if people go into that conversation knowing what their relatives' wishes are.
Mm. But there's not always a correlation between the amount of people who have signed up. Sweden, very, very high rates of people, awareness, signing up to donate, but it doesn't equal a higher rate of donation.
There is no magic bullet. You've got to get lots of stuff lined up. That's the point.
Yeah, I was just responding to some of your narrative there. I mean, it doesn't, you know, I think we both agree it doesn't always equate to an increase in the Spanish focus in that important conversation.
Indeed.
Which is at the point where a donor can be identified and there's an outcome there that is to be sought after, I suppose, that the important conversation is at that time of death, not when we all decide to sign up on a Saturday night with the Chinese or something. You know, so we'll come to some of that later, maybe with the legal requirements and whatever. Yes.
Thank you. I'm also a transplant surgeon as well as being vice president of the British Transplantation Society, just to put whatever I say in context. Two points that Sally has raised, which I think are worth reiterating. One is the provision of intensive care unit beds. And I think that is a real challenge for us around organ donation. While there is pressure on intensive care unit beds, then the length of time that is required to ensure those conversations are had without any sense of urgency and to allow the relatives to come to terms with what is happening, has happened to their loved one, I think could be their care of the relatives, if you like, could be improved with improved provision of intensive care unit beds. And the second point I want to make is really to emphasise the positive aspects of the publicity campaigns that have been run in Scotland. And you're right, of course, the important conversations take place at a tragic time, but one could envisage that it's much easier for a relative to make the decision for organ donation if they knew that that was the wish of the person who has just died and if they had already had that conversation. So I think that the publicity campaigns are also very important as they encourage people to have the We Chat.
And
support what Lorna and Sally have said, that if there is the potential for donation in either the intensive care unit or the emergency department, we are contacted and we would be having that conversation with those families if there's potential for donation.
But we heard last week there's somebody else, a couple about it, you know, you may want to respond to it. Well, I've got a question on that intensive care beds. Does that mean that if we had more, we would have more donations or more ICT units, we would have more donations?
I think that our intensive care colleagues would probably say that we would be able to have more organ donors if we had more intensive care beds. I'm trying to recall the exact figures. We've got about 10 per million population intensive care beds in the UK, and I think Spain are about 23 per million population, so there's quite a big gap.
Mm. So that would be the focus on the ICT units, as we, that's where these conversations are more likely to take place. You know, so that the other question that follows from that is that I think in your evidence you said that this bill could create another 70 transplants or so.
Well, what my statistics department have done is they've gone through a kind of quite a complicated assessment And it does depend on a whole range of things. So it does depend on obviously making sure that every donor after circulatory death is referred, and that we achieve consent rates which are broadly similar to the best in the world. But yes, that could be at the upper end of what we could expect to see. Yeah.
And you went on to on this issue of capacity, the capacity of the ICD beds, the intensive care beds, the capacity within the workforce to take, because you're saying that if we generated these additional transplants, we're going to test the capacity that we've got. Is that what you were suggesting in your evidence?
Yes, that's true. I think that we'd have to work this through very carefully, but we have limited numbers of staff on call at any one time, and they have to cover quite large distances, as you can appreciate. And I think then we may find that there are times when we would have to call in people who were not normally on call, and that would put strain on the system. We might need some additional staff to cover the on call.
So to to cope with any additional, even the additional 70, we would have to increase the levels of staff. And I'm just trying to get to the point that this is not a silver bullet. There's a whole lot of issues here.
I mean, we in Scotland, we have about 100 donors a year.
Uh-huh.
So an extra 70 is quite a big hike up. And that's quite a lot for the team to cope with.
Mm-hmm. That lack of capacity with the increase, are we coping with the capacity now?
Oh, yeah.
We're coping with the capacity, but we could do more if we had more intensive beds or we had more staff that would deal with any subsequent rise in those people who were prepared to donate.
We could, but I think we should just be slightly cautious about assuming that the intensive care beds would automatically bring the extra number of donors. It would probably give us some more capacity to admit people through accident and emergency departments into intensive care. But in reality, if you have more intensive care beds, they're mostly filled up with more people who need intensive care.
I'm aware of displacement and actually saving people's lives as well. We heard last week from clinicians that some clinicians are more enthusiastic about this. Now, that might be part of the problem. My job is to try and save that person rather than, bring about an organ donation. Mm. So there's priorities there. I can, but is that an issue in terms of, you say you have clinical leads for transplantation in Spain. There is a division between those clinicians who are actively fighting to save that person. They decide that person can't be saved. They go through the normal procedures and agreement that the person is brain dead, and then they hand it over to a completely different team.
And in our case, this is part of the team that they would hand to.
But if we agree that some clinician consultants are more keen on transplantation, organ donation, then we've got the hierarchy that exists, whether we like it or not, about how much influence nurses have in that process as against the consultant influence on that process.
I think that you've got two different areas of work here, really. One is, if you like, the acute situation, a potential donor in the intensive care unit. And the other aspect is really a lot of groundwork that has gone on that as part of the outcome of the Organ Donation Task Force, to really work with the Intensive Care Society and intensive care units across the UK to promote organ donation. Because you're right, arguably it's a conflict for many intensivists as they work so hard to save people's lives. And I think even some of the clinicians historically particularly have struggled with then changing their viewpoint to consider organ donation. But a huge amount of work has done, and NHSBT, as already described, have set up the clinical leads for organ donation. They are consultants, usually have some input into intensive care, either as anaesthetists or as intensive care consultants. So they understand the workings of the intensive care unit, and they are our ambassadors for organ donation at consultant level across the UK. And this is really part of a huge amount of background work to work with all parts of that team to encourage organ donation and promote organ donation. And that has been a key part of the work of the last 7 years now, isn't it?
When they're not there, they're not there 24 hours, nor are the nurses.
But so if they've done the work on the ground about promoting organ donation and working with their colleagues to actually encourage them to believe in organ donation, then that will continue even if they're not there. And that is what we've seen, and that's why we've seen in Scotland an 82% increase in the number of organ donors since the
report. So we don't lose out on organ donations because the consultant's not there or the nurses are, and Irene Young's desperate to get in here and just say, no, we don't.
Part of my role is to work with the clinical lead in my hospital. And my role is to audit deaths within the unit as well as education. And I'll go into the unit every day to see whether there's somebody who could become a potential donor on that given day. And because of the work I'm doing with my clinical lead, if someone slips through the net, they will be challenged, that particular consultant will be challenged by my clinical lead at their weekly senior medical staff meeting. So in a way, it's almost like a drip feed system that we've had. As the medical staff have become more comfortable with our role, they're more comfortable actually discussing potential donors with us because they see us going into unit every day. And if they do forget, in inverted commas, to refer a potential donor to us, then either my clinical lead or myself will pick that up through our daily visits or weekly meetings in the unit. And that's replicated through all hospitals within Scotland. So that's, if you want, it's a safety net.
Yeah.
I think what's also very important to say is that a lot of our referrals for donation do come out of ours. And I think that's through an awful lot of the work that we've done in the hospitals. As Lorna and Sally have alluded to, there's a huge amount of work going on with the clinical leads and with us as a service. So they know how to refer, they know how to get in touch with us, and we do run a 24/7 on-call service so that we would be able to go in.
Okay. Malcolm Chisholm.
Quite a lot of your evidence was about the role of proxies and the authorised investigating persons, and that's come up in previous evidence as well, so I'm quite interested in those two areas. And I suppose the other issue I'm interested in, reflected in some of the evidence, is how what's proposed in the bill compares with what already happens in other parts of the UK. So starting with proxies, I think there's an issue about the number, and there's three proposed, and I believe there's two in other parts of the UK, so I imagine that wouldn't be an issue of principle in terms of the Scottish Bill. But could you tell us if the role of the proxy in other parts of the UK is similar or different to the role envisaged in the Bill?
It's very similar. I think one of the things that perhaps people aren't aware of, I think at the moment we've got 15 people registered as proxies across the UK, despite the fact that that's been possible for some time now. It is because you have to provide a witnessed evidence that somebody wants to be a proxy. It's not as easy to do as... But then again, you can't really just send somebody else's details off to NHS Blood and Transplant to go on a register without their authorisation to do so. So we do have to make sure that the processes are right to get people authorised. So I don't think my specialist nurses have ever actually dealt with a proxy. That's so rare.
Never. No, I haven't.
Just directly with the family.
But for whatever reason, it's not been used. But in principle, is the role similar, and would they be able to? I think one of the issues is the relationship in the bill that would arise between proxies and families. But potentially, could that kind of situation arise in other parts of the UK, even although it doesn't tend to because there aren't any?
It could, yes. Yeah. I mean, there's always a challenge when you have different people with different roles trying to agree on the same thing. I mean, and the nurses would probably say that it's hard enough sometimes to get family members to agree without throwing anything else into the mix.
We may come back to that. Professor Britton wants to respond, Malcolm.
Okay.
I think we had said in our submission that the appointment of a proxy does seem to be an accepted form of medical decision making, and we would support the appointment of the proxy. However, we do have concerns that the bill provides that the proxy does not need to be informed of their appointment, and find that quite incomprehensible. It's such an intimate moment, such an important decision to be made, such a responsibility, that the individual might not even know, particularly when time may be of the essence that such a decision is going to be made.
So that's interesting. But presumably an amendment could be proposed, but it wouldn't change the principle. In principle, you support the idea, and also you're saying it's established practice across the UK. I mean, I think that's quite useful, because I think some of the evidence on the bill has suggested that this is some new idea, that why is it being introduced? And it may well be that...
Sure. In other forms of decision-making, if the patient, for example, becomes incapacitated, looking for a proxy or somebody acting in an advocate's role would not be unusual. But the emphasis on the face of the bill is looking for this three-tiered cascading proxy process. We would not want to see that the family are being marginalised in any way. The role of the family seems to us to be absolutely fundamental. And if they're the ones sitting around the bedside, surely they would be the ones to have this conversation with, rather than taking the time to find a proxy who may or may not know that they have even been appointed.
Lorna Marson?
I mean, I'd like to really reiterate what Professor Britton just said. I'm not clear what added value a proxy would bring in this set of circumstances. I think we have to understand that there is an urgency about the decision-making process, and that already some families withdraw authorisation for organ donation because of the length of time that it takes to do that. I think the other thing is that we are reliant on the family as professionals, as the specialist nurses particularly, to gain as much information about the donor as possible, the medical information, their behavioural information about the donor, in order to assess the safety of those organs for transplantation. And we've recently had high profile cases of transmission of donor disease into recipients elsewhere in the country. We are reliant on the families for much of that information, and therefore anything that marginalises those families from this decision-making, I think, has potential to be detrimental to the process and to the safety of those organs for transplantation.
Okay, thanks for that. Can I go on to the authorised investigating person? Again, my understanding is that there is such a role in Wales, and therefore, again, I'm wondering, or do you see it as different from the role in Wales?
Wales. So in Wales, the specialist nurse approaches the family as they do currently, and I guess I was trying to describe what the difference between the different legal systems are last night. And currently, anybody in the UK can join the organ donor register, can record a refusal to donate, or can appoint a proxy, except within Scotland, or appoint a representative. In the UK, excepting Wales, as of today, if you haven't done one of those three things, it is your family's responsibility to make your organ donation, make the organ donation decision on your behalf. If in Wales you have done none of those things, you have deemed your consent by your inaction, and the expectation is, unless the family has strong evidence that you did not wish to be a donor, that you will then go on to donate. If we look at the authorised investigating person, then it seems to me, from what I've been able to understand from reading this, that they need to apply a series of cascading tests to determine whether there is any reason why you should not be an organ donor, and then authorise the donation. And certainly that does not appear to be a role which is entirely consistent with supporting the family through this process. So it appears to be an additional role.
And I'm unclear as to how that would work with the other people involved in this process, how the timing would work, and what that might do in terms of the family experience of organ donation.
I mean, I think the intention is it's not an additional role. I mean, it may be that the member will ask you questions about that, but I think the intention is, which is why I drew the Wales analogy, that the role of the specialist nurse changes. And is that not the case in Wales? The role of the specialist nurse has changed with the new legislation that starts today. I think that's the analogy that's intended.
They have a more presumptive approach when they talk to the family, but it is still about working it through with the family. There's not a suggestion that the family, that you know, are to at the end of the process or may not have a voice in it. And certainly, you know, the discussions we've had with our nurses is a certain sense that being an authorised investigating person and the legal requirement of that presents some conflicts with their family care role.
I think the Law Society has a view. That would be interesting to hear your view on that.
I think just following through on what was said there, this looks a very complex and onerous role, because you're not only applying the interpretation, I agree, you're looking at this cascading process here in relation to proxy decision making. But at the end of the day, there is nothing in the face of this bill or in the policy memorandum or in the explanatory notes that even mentions consent. The focus of this bill is about authorisation. And the buck stops with the AIP, that they take the final decision whether or not authorisation can be given or not. So this individual, I think, should probably not be a healthcare professional, because to me that would seem to be a conflict of interest. And from the one hand, you have somebody advising the family, counselling the family, taking medical history. They may have one view, the family may have views, and then this authorisation needs to be given. So we remain unclear who exactly would take on this role.
Well, I mean, I think that certainly merits a lot further investigation, but my understanding is the intention is it should not be a new role, but it should be a changing role of the people who deal with these matters at present. So,
I mean, the box stop now, is that with...
Well, ultimately, providing the buck stops with the family to...
Based on the information and the
discussion. I mean, yes, if somebody has given authorisation on the organ donor register, they have given authorisation. But, you know, we are in a uniquely sensitive arena here. Mm-hmm. And we want to work with the consent and cooperation of the families, not just because we think it's best for the family, but also because it's safest for the potential transplant recipient. What we don't want is a family who doesn't cooperate and doesn't give us all the information that we require to make sure the transplant's going to be safe. And we know, I mean, you saw evidence from some of the families, some of the questions we have to ask are quite difficult and quite intrusive. It's hard enough asking those questions to a family that has said they want to be support organ donation. It would be very much harder for a family that didn't wish to support organ donation.
But surely there's no suggestion in the bill that...
Malcolm. Is there any other response? Because Professor Britton, did you...
No.
My final point. Surely there's no suggestion in the bill that the wishes of the family are going to be overridden. I mean, there's obviously an issue when there's a proxy, which may be in a small number of places, but it's not clear to me. And again, it's in the bit where you say there'll be 70 plus extra donors, which is in itself, I would have thought, a very strong argument for the bill. But then you go on to say that the law as currently proposed may result in conflict with the families, but it's not clear to me why it will, because the families are still being asked, and there's no suggestion that the nurse is going to disregard the views of the family.
My reading of the bill and the accompanying memorandum was that if the authorised investigating person authorised donation, then that would proceed, regardless of the family's situation. Unless the family had strong evidence that the individual had said they were not prepared to authorise organ donation, then it read to me as though the AIP would authorise regardless, and that's where I think the concern arises.
But the, presu-
I agree with Ms. Johnson. In our submission, I actually pointed out the confusion here. On the face of the bill, the family are consulted only to clarify what the wishes of the patient may have been. And the policy memorandum at paragraph 37 says, and I quote, "The bill does not allow relatives to block the removal of organs by reference to their own views and preferences about organ donation. They are consulted only to help establish whether the deceased person had expressed any objection." And then paragraph 55, again of the policy memorandum, says, "The current position of not removing organs, if doing so would cause significant distress to the family, even if authorisation exists," and says nothing in the bill changes this. Given the importance that we've heard about the role of the family, that is really not clear at all what the role of the family is actually going to be.
Yes, Ivy.
From a practical point of view, I think the AIP, we're dealing with families at a very, very sensitive period in their life. And I think if an outside agency or outside person's coming in who's maybe not clinical, if they decide that donation is to go ahead and the family don't agree with that, I think that may cause problems. Part of my role when a family says no is to try and find out why they're saying no. It may be because they don't actually understand the process. So my job is to try and tease out from them why they're saying no. And quite often, if we can correct their misconceptions about their understanding about the donation process, they then change their mind and go on to say, yes, if you've got an AIP fulfilling this role, that part may go and you may lose a potential donor.
The tasks that I've described and that would be carried out by the AIP are standard. They're not a contention, you know, establishing whether it's a good donor, whether the person's resident in Scotland, all you know, and the legal requirements. So the tasks themselves are would be standard, or maybe could be described even more so. So is it not a question of clarity? Because we've identified some problems earlier on sometimes about the complexities within the system, about some more, you know, in terms of capacity, or some clinicians more enthusiastic than others, and the different priorities. Is there not a role and a more presumptive organ donation scheme or retrieval scheme that somebody, whether it be, I think it was described in last week's evidence, that it was described that the specialist nurses actually do a lot of this now.
Yes.
So it's not about, you know, whether this job needs done, or whether would it be better if this was on a more legal footing or not? Would that aid the presumption, the direction that we're travel?
I think from an NHSBT perspective, and it's really important, we'll work within whatever legal framework we're given. Obviously, you know, that's what our role is, but we do want to make sure that it's as easy for all of the families and clinical staff involved to come to what we believe is the right outcome, which is to say yes to donation, and that it's clear about who's responsible for what, how the different parts work, and that it happens smoothly and, importantly, quickly. Because we know that particularly for donors after circulatory death, there are often families who have had no rest. You know, they are absolutely strung out, and they can't take very much more time to make a decision. And therefore, the longer it takes, the more likely it is that you end up with the wrong outcome.
Rhoda Grant.
I suppose, can I turn the questions on their head slightly? My understanding is the role of the AIP is to give people a bit of comfort that things are done properly, and that, you know, everything has been properly investigated and people's organs are not being taken without their consent. How can we achieve the same level of confidence? Maybe using the specialist nurse, what kind of precautions would have to be on the face of the bill, and what happens anyway to make sure that this would never happen, to give that level of comfort.
I suppose I'm partly quite shocked at the idea that people think that organs are taken without appropriate authorisation at the moment. So I hope that's not the case.
That's not what I meant. I think because we're changing, the bill is changing.
Yes. So how do you, in a presumptive situation? I think it is about being able to set out very clearly what the expectation is of the people of the country in which you are. So what Wales have done is have very much said, you've got choices, you need to make decisions, but if you don't make decisions, this is what will happen, with a very intensive communications campaign, which has lasted 2 years, and which has certainly done leaflet drops to every single household twice, plus an additional drop to everyone approaching the age of 18. So something about getting everybody to understand what the law is that's operating. And, you know, it's day one today, so they haven't quite done the launch is kind of now, which is where I was going to be. that's fine. So to some extent, you know, this is new in terms of how you deal with families and make sure that they have confidence. But the expectation is that the nurses will explain to families that, you know, this is how the law works in this country. These are the options that people have. We've checked the organ donor register, and this is what your relative had decided. Either they had recorded a decision or they hadn't. If they hadn't recorded a decision, then the expectation is that they would go on to be organ donors, but there is permission with it. There is within the law in Wales and within the code of practice clear expectation that if somebody doesn't join the organ donor register but very clearly makes their wishes known to their family, so by that I think you have to test for reasonableness about their unwillingness to be a donor, and that would be something along the lines of the nurses exploring with the family, you know, they haven't recorded a decision on the register. They're expected, therefore, to donate because they've deemed their consent. Have you any information otherwise? And if the family said, oh, well, they told us they didn't want to be a donor, the nurse would then need to go on to explore what that conversation was like. So was it a flippant remark on the way out to make a cup of tea that said, well, they wouldn't want my liver, so, you know, not after all I've drunk, so don't sign me up for that? Or is it a proper discussion between the family about what they wanted to happen? And clearly, if it is the latter, then donation would not proceed because that would be clear evidence the person didn't wish to be a donor. If it were the former, then the nurse would need to test that out with the family to see how strong that intention was. And that's how you give confidence, by working with the family, in much the same way as we do currently, really.
Okay.
Just a brief observation on that, that on the face of the bill just now, a proxy decision maker may not necessarily be a family member, and the provision is that they would be consulted in this three-stage cascading process, perhaps even before any family member is approached.
I think I'll leave the proxy just to the side, because I think that was instead of a family member, and certainly people representing the views of looked after children, for example, were very keen on a proxy because they didn't have close family who could make that decision for them. So I don't think we see a proxy as the normal. It's the exception to the rule. But going back to the AIP, we took evidence earlier in the process from clinicians who said, even under this bill, if they have a duty of care towards the family as well, and that is normal. So if it looked as if the presumption to donate was going to cause additional distress to the family, well, bearing in mind they're already distressed, additional distress to the family, then they wouldn't go ahead with that. In spite of the family not having a role on the face of the bill, the duty of care on clinicians would actually give that protection to families.
I think that's absolutely one of the most important issues to my mind about this bill, is that actually ultimately it is very unlikely that any of us that work in the clinical arena will go directly against the wishes of a family who are at the beginning of what will be an intense grieving process. And I think that's right. I think it's right for, as a clinician, I think it's right, but also I think it's right because we've all seen the negative, the power of negative publicity, and it would only take one bad story about transplanters taking organs from somebody whose family didn't want them to actually have a potentially have a significant impact on the number of organ donors we see. And we've seen that historically with organ retention scandals in the past. It does impact on people's behaviour. So I think for lots of reasons, it is right that even irrespective almost of the legislation, that the family's wishes are taken into account. And my colleagues work every day with families such as these to try and encourage them towards organ donation, but ultimately to accept if their views are strongly held against it. And that will not change, should not change.
Do you want to test that? We had some evidence to you about the ECHR in this field, where it would come into play. Just
yes, if I can just ask, yep. what one final question on that. Do we need the role of the AIP then? Can specialist nurses carry out the protections of the bill?
I think my concern about the role is that if you've got a family who are against donation and the AIP decides for it, my role is to find, as Lorna and Sally have explained earlier on, is to find out as much information about the donor as possible to make sure the donation is safe. If you make a decision that goes against their direct wishes, how cooperative would that family be with me when I need to find out some of the most important information I can find out for the transplantation? I think that would be my big concern. If you bring another role in, or another person into the equation, that the family aren't quite sure who they are, I think that may cause problems.
Yes.
I think there's also a huge amount to say that of the relationship that we have with families just now and the work that we are doing. It is a dreadful time for them, as we've heard already from our speakers. And I think to change things dramatically would potentially cause problems. At the moment, we work collaboratively with the intensive care units and the ED departments. They form a relationship, if they can, with those families to take them through, which will be a dreadful grieving process for them. We equally support that in the collaborative work that we do in coming in with organ donation and having that chance to form the relationship and gain all the understanding and information that we need from that family at that difficult time.
Yes, Professor Britton.
Following on from a legal point of view, if that engagement with the family was ongoing, then we would not see the AIP in this role of possible conflict with the family needing to legally arbitrate what if a decision could not be reached. But if you are having this clinical approach, that time is taken with the family from people who are experienced in this area and have been experienced for years in this area, we would certainly see less potential for conflict there.
Yeah, I think it was in that context. I think we've had some evidence that if the family's wishes were overruled, then it could engage Article 8 of ACHR. Is that something that you would see happening?
I don't think we didn't... look at that in our submission. In the Article 8, right to a private life. Again, maybe I'd have to take this away and think about it a bit more, which I will do, but briefly today, I don't think that you would be invoking anything
different in examining the rights under Article 8 that you may not be looking at already. You would be looking at the autonomy of the individual. What views did they have? Can we build a picture on what their views and preferences would have been there? And in the absence of any evidence to that state, then I would think that there may be a challenge. But I'm not really seeing a situation, given the conversation we've had today, that the views, the values of the family, the views of the individual would not be fully explored.
Can I just finally, just based on what Irene Young said earlier, so if the family didn't agree to donation, and I think we are agreed, but we're talking almost the worst case scenario. I think we're agreed that if the family don't agree, nobody would put them through that. But as an added protection without the role of the AIP, if the family felt that they were in some way being pushed into this and they didn't agree, they'd just withdraw their information about the potential donor.
I suppose potentially they could, and that would be, you know, to the detriment of potential transplantation. Because if I can't, you know, donation can go ahead with a limited amount of information, but the danger with that is that you could transmit potentially life-threatening conditions to the person who's receiving the transplant. So it's vitally important that we're able to build up a relationship with the family so they trust us and they will impart information to us. I mean, we also, you know, contact the family GP and other clinicians who are involved in the patient's care, but it's vital that we get information from the family about the day-to-day existence of that person. You know, GPs may not know everything about, you know, somebody. You may have a patient that doesn't regularly attend the GP at all. So it's really important that I gain the family's trust to enable them to give me that information.
Mike McKenzie.
Thank you, Convener. The bill seems to me to carry the fundamental implicit assumption that introducing an opt-out system rather than the current opt-in will in of itself give rise to a greater supply of organs. Would you agree with that fundamental assumption? And if not, why not?
I don't think that the evidence based on the international evidence, based on the Spanish model or Belgium or other countries that have an opt-out legislation, is clear that in itself increases the numbers of organs for donation. I don't think we know the answer.
So we can't really say one way or another?
So, well, having some of those opt-out systems have been set up for 20 years, for example, in Belgium, and so actually if they're not clearly increasing the number of organ donors in themselves, then one could argue that in itself that change in legislation is not going to make a difference to organ donor numbers.
Thank you. Any other witnesses with views on that? Or even if you're reluctant to state a particular view, it would be interesting, I think, for the committee to consider the arguments on either side, because some previous witnesses have suggested reasons why they feel it may have the opposite effect, and there are those, of course, that feel it would increase the supply. So from your respective perspectives, I think it would be useful to, you know, for the committee to hear the pros and cons, as it were.
From a legal point of view, we would be asking the question, what would legislation in this area bring to the debate that is not already there or to the process? But we cannot comment on the medical side in relation to statistics.
Accepting that that will not be the only factor, and there's many factors, yes, that will influence this, is it not the case that those countries with the soft opt-out generally have higher organ donations?
There is some evidence that there is a correlation between a high donor rate and soft opt-out, but there is no cause and effect between the two.
Yeah.
Absolutely proven. That's the difference.
Yes, and that's helpful.
And if you think about Spain and Belgium, you know, Spain has been pursuing 40 donors per million population since 1989. We've been at this game since 2008. We're doing pretty well in catching up.
Oh, yeah.
And so I think it's just, there are, you know, I would caution against thinking that anything is a magic bullet.
Yes.
I wish there were one, otherwise I'd be firing.
I think what we're searching for is if we could do better. If this is all about, you know, partly about cultural change, changing attitudes within those, you know, people who work in that area, would this be an aid? Would this generate that debate that takes us that other step? It's incremental. We're not implying any criticism at all about the current system. I think we're examining a proposal that seeks to take us that other step, that, you know, and make some additional progress. That, I think that's what we're
examining.
It
might be worth, I mean, one of the things that is definitely evidenced in Wales is that when they started on this journey, hardly anybody in the country thought about organ donation. And their latest survey, I think, I can't remember the exact figures, but they would certainly be able to tell you, now has something like over 80% of the population is aware of the legislation. So they have got something into the, you know, the consciousness of the public through going through a legislative process accompanied by a very thorough communication process. And we wait to see what will happen.
Yes.
And that's the interesting point, isn't it? I think it's whether a very good communication process without the change in legislation would have the same impact. We don't know. But certainly in Scotland we have, as I mentioned already, run publicity campaigns where there is evidence that that has led to an increase in the number of people signing up for the organ donor register.
So is it possible then to argue that irrespective of the bill going any further or not, that in engendering the conversations that we've had, covering areas tangential to the subject matter of the bill, even that's of benefit? So this bill is already creating a, you know, a benign, a good, a helpful effect.
There seems little doubt that it has raised the profile, shared through the media, conversations. It's, you know, reaching people's homes, people's consciousness. And this really should be about dialogue, good communication. So if it contributes towards that good communication, then yes, it is a positive thing.
Yeah. And last question, Convener. Last week, the committee heard from a gentleman who I think he was a bioethicist, but he specialised in ethics. And it seems to me we had a fairly theoretical discussion, which seemed to centre about his view that that we own our organs even after death. That was a concept I struggled with. In terms of, I can't, you know, imagine that we own anything else after our death, but are you able to give or shed light on a more, from a more practical standpoint on the ethics that attend this issue?
There is many different views as there are ethicists.
Yeah. And I think it's a discussion and a topic of debate. Do your organs belong to the state, whatever that is, at the time of death, or do they belong to you, or do they belong to your family? And I think, I suppose, being a clinician and being a surgeon, so at the kind of practical end of the clinical side, I would say, well, in a sense, clearly that's an important argument to have as a bioethicist, but actually if you're faced with these decisions in the middle of the night, we adopt a rather more pragmatic approach. And I think that is around making the right decision for the transplant community, but for the donor family as well. And I think we have to remember in this that donor families who do agree to donate organs gain a huge amount, sometimes of solace, and I'm sure you've heard from donor families during this discussion, that some good has come out of this tragedy. So I would avoid the question by responding in a kind of more pragmatic way.
Yes, Professor Britton.
I think it's all about respect at the end of the day, rather than trying to focus on the legal ownership of organs, which, yes, that debate is there. But if you reach an agreement at the end of the day where the families feel that the adults, their loved ones' wishes have been respected, there has been an agreement and organ donation has or has not taken place, I think that would have more value under those scenarios than arguing about ownership.
Was Wade.
I think
behalf of the families that we've worked with, I think they feel that their loved ones are giving something absolutely huge for the benefit of others.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mike. Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. I wonder if I could maybe turn to the organ donation register. It's been basically set up from the Welsh system. Some areas seem to me, and I think the Law Society indicated that there was an issue maybe about data protection with regard to proxy. Would that be the case? I mean, if we don't have that a signature from the proxy or the representative, and that signature has been witnessed, therefore it wouldn't be compliant and couldn't be entered into the register. Would that be the case?
That wasn't something we made a submission on. We talked about the proxy decision maker knowing that they would be involved in this process, but we didn't personally see the value in looking at whether or not any signatures had been made there. It wasn't something we submitted on.
With regard to data protection, where would we stand in terms of entering in details of, say, a proxy without their consent?
The data protection would not be compromised unless you were forcing the proxy decision maker to make a decision at that time. And there's nothing on the face of the bill which would suggest that the proxy decision maker would be being forced into making a decision. So on that case, they're then not being a proxy. If they're not making a decision, they're not representing the wishes or views or values of the adult in question, then they would not be a proxy at that time, and that would not be compromised. Yeah.
So there's no compromise to data protection at all within the register?
In my view, if the proxy decision maker, who has been appointed without their knowledge, refuses then to make any decision, there would not be any compromise.
Okay. Yeah.
Sally Johnson.
My understanding and the advice that I have received is that we cannot hold data about people that has not been given to us by the person. Mm-hmm. So even if you don't have it witnessed and all of that rigmarole, I can't volunteer Liz as my proxy and ask the organ donor register to hold her data without her consent to do that. So so that's really important.
So you're saying that the information could not be entered into the register then?
Not without the agreement of the person who's been nominated.
Okay. I wonder, Convener, if I could move to the age of consent, because there obviously is a difference, and the Organ Tissue Scotland Act 2006, a 12-year-old can enter themselves into the register so they can opt in. Without parental consent. But we're also looking at the age of consent within England and Wales as a child being under the age of 18, whereas being proposed at 16 in Scotland. What does that present a degree of conflict? Does it make it difficult then in terms of entering information to the register?
Yes, Professor.
Three observations there. The first one, that the current position, as you rightly say, is that a young person from the age of 12 can opt in. And our view is that it's perhaps a different question whether or not that they are deemed to be opting in unless they opt out. So I think it is a slightly more onerous decision for them to make. And we would prefer that they had that opportunity to weigh up the pros and cons of making that decision. Mm-hmm. Age of Legal Capacity Scotland Act allows a young person from the age of 16 to consent or refuse consent to medical treatment. Mm-hmm. And perhaps something that we need to be thought about further, I'm not sure that agreeing to organ donation is actually medical treatment. But the last point, and perhaps the most important, is if we are looking for a consistency in relation to the United Kingdom, the Welsh provision has provided for aged 18. So it also hopes that if somebody from another jurisdiction, so you've got a young person from Scotland in Wales, it puts them in quite a difficult position if they're maybe 17 and their organs are going to be taken. Whereas if they're 18 years of age, there's a consistency across the UK. If this is again about informing the public to make informed choices, it's probably easier to apply this consistency if the age limit is the same in Wales as it would be perhaps in Scotland and indeed any other jurisdiction in the UK that takes this on board.
Anyone else wish to respond to that age question? I'm thinking it wouldn't cause you a problem, would it, in terms of 16 or 18?
It adds a complexity. So as I understand it, the law as currently written says, was the individual resident in Scotland at the time of the death? So you could be resident in Scotland at the time of your death, but you might die on a day trip to London. And, you know, these things do unfortunately happen.
Yeah.
And then you have inconsistencies in the approach. You know, we have to train all of our nurses to understand the law in each country because death, sadly, is no respecter of country boundaries. And therefore, the more complexity there is, the higher the risk of getting it wrong. That's the only thing that we would say is, you know, it's just an operational matter. It's trying to remember all the twiddles in the different laws if they're all different.
Dennis.
Yeah, thank you. The other area that we really haven't explored terribly much is this time factor. I'm slightly confused because I don't know what the time factor is in terms of the discussion with the family and what the window would be in terms of organs being available for donation, because, you know, we are aware that this discussion needs to take place, and it needs to take place fairly quickly. The bill refers to, you know, the sort of time frame, but we don't have, you know, so many hours or days or whatever. What is this time frame that we actually do have? For instance, if someone has a sudden death on a theatre table, the family, you know, everyone going to theatre, I suppose, has a degree of risk. But you can have sudden deaths or unexpected deaths. How do we deal with that, and what is the time frame?
We take it away from sudden death and look at what we were speaking about before with the brainstem death or the donation after circulatory arrest. Then there is a time frame where there's going to be, in brainstem death, there's going to be a series of tests that are carried out. And there's also going to be discussion from a clinician that that person is not going to survive. There's then going to be the added discussion of futility, that we're going to look at options, and one of them would be potentially organ donation with that family, and the same in the donation after circulatory death. So there will be a planned conversation, with a collaborative conversation between a clinician, a specialist nurse, and that family to take forward the discussions around organ donation. The other time frames for that is, if the family do say yes, is how we actually plan that whole process. And that's where timings come in for the families and for the units. We could have somebody donating a number of organs. All organs have to be offered out and placed across the country. So that can take time. We have blood tests and things to perform. We've spoken already about the safety of transplantation. So there are elements within that process that we have to follow. That takes time. There's also theatres to be set up, and there's also the expertise of the surgical teams who will come out and retrieve those organs. So that is all within the time frame. These are all the discussions in the training that we've had and how we take the families through that whole process and explain to them what that time frame may be. So we could be looking at 10 to 16 hours from a conversation to get everything set in place before the death could happen for that person, particularly in the donation after circulatory death, and before organs are retrieved. And that is the timings that we speak about and how we take that family forward in those very important discussions and information setting.
Would we require to have a time frame in legislation, or is it so flexible that it wouldn't, you wouldn't, unless, maybe not on the face of the bill, but maybe in the guidance notes or whatever, should we have that specific time frame in order that people are very much aware that it is a time restraint, that, you know, conversations need to happen very quickly? We don't have days.
We don't have days, but I think the time frames can be flexible with the families and how we take the process forward.
Okay. Is there any member who hasn't asked any question who wishes to ask a question?
No.
Richard Lyle.
Thank you. Can I go back? And first of all, I think my first question was, and I complimented what the work that you're doing, so no one's criticising. But can I ask Irene Young and Liz Waite, how many hospitals actually do you cover? Because data shows that the consent rate rises around 33% when specialist nurses for organ donation are involved in the approach. But also the same data shows that the specialist nurses for organ donation are only involved in around 76% of approaches to families. So do we actually physically need more of you to have one, I see nodding heads, to have one specialist nurse in a hospital? I don't know how many hospitals you cover, but you're 24/7 and you're out of hours and et cetera, and I compliment you on the work you're doing. But I'd be interested to know how many hospitals actually you personally, both of you, do cover.
Thank you. At the moment, for the service, we have 26 and 18 hospitals. 26 in Scotland. So we cover all the hospitals. We have a team of people who are on call. As you say, that in the statistics that you quoted, there are times when we're not involved. That could be dependent on our travel to those hospitals. It could be out of hours when we're being called and we're trying to get there. And there are some times that these conversations may happen with the clinicians, with the families, pretty quickly, because they have asked a question already. There are families who do raise donation, and they may have asked that question. So it could well be that we are en route to that hospital and that we will take part in those discussions and we will take forward donation if that's agreeable. But it may well be that clinicians have started the process already in some of those cases that you've mentioned where we're not present.
Yeah, so it'd be very hard for you, with the greatest respect, to, if a clinician's had a discussion with the family and they've said no, you know, they're distressed and all the different things, it's very hard for you to come in back in and try and get them back into the room to rediscuss, isn't it?
It would be very, very difficult. And in those situations, we have not been involved in many of them where you would go back and speak to the family again. They've probably given very good reasons. And the clinicians as well, we've already spoken about the education of our clinicians. The clinicians will also try to explore why the family have any misconceptions and maybe not wanting donation to go forward.
I think part of my embedded role, I'm based in the Royal Infirmary in Edinburgh, so part of my role is to go down into the unit every day and say, hello, how are you? Basically what's happening in the unit today. And by doing that, what we're trying to do is to get the clinicians to refer patients to us as early as possible. I may not be on call that day, but I can start the process off and my on-call colleague can then make their way through to the hospital and they'll take over from me and carry out the rest of the process overnight. And the reason behind us doing that is to make sure that we're cutting the time down as much as possible. We're not putting the family through a long, drawn-out process. So that's the idea behind having an embedded SNOD in each hospital. Most of us will cover either one hospital or two. I only cover the Royal because it's quite a big hospital, several intensive care units and an emergency medicine department. Some of my colleagues will cover two of the smaller district general hospitals because there's less potential there.
So, sorry, Convener, just lastly, and I'm going to ask you, if we had a specialist nurse in every hospital in Scotland, would that raise the organ donation rate? Yes or no?
I don't think we can be certain. One of the things that we are testing currently is whether if a nurse engages and approaches more families in the role that's called a designated requester role, whether they become more expert and get higher rates of consent. The early evidence from that is promising. Therefore, if you put a nurse in every hospital
At the moment, on average, our nurses do 15 approaches a year. A designated requester does about 60. If you had a nurse in every hospital, that would drop from 15 to lower, and you might actually lower your rate of consent.
Thank you very much.
Should there be one in every intensive care unit then?
At the moment, there is an availability in Scotland that there will be a nurse in every intensive care unit, in particularly the big donating hospitals. In the district general, we have supplementary where somebody else will cover that hospital.
That being to intents and purposes, then that is
yes.
It's already happening in practice.
Yes.
And given that they will only engage with a few families annually, what are the other aspects of the role? Are the other aspects of the role about education, communication?
There's education, there's promotion, there's the whole hospital development of the whole hospital approach to look at organ donation throughout that hospital. Uh-huh. So there's a huge amount going on. And the audit. We mentioned the audit before. There is the audit of every single death, which is very important to show that we're not missing anybody.
Is there any other members got a question? Dennis Robertson, I see.
Quickly, I don't know the figures. I just wonder if you have them. But in terms of donations, do we have figures to give us an indication how many donations are under the age of, say, 18, sort of from the paediatric side, and then the adults? I'm just wondering, are there more in terms of the younger age group?
I can let the committee have the donors broken down by age over the last few years, if that would be helpful. I don't carry that data in my head for Scotland.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks. That's convenient.
But generally, are you saying the younger age are a minority?
No, the average age of our donors is over 50.
Yeah, where in Spain it's over 60 and... The majority of the donors, and they're doing older for older. And
one caution word.
Right,
caution.
Yeah, that's why you're here.
We use all but about 5% of organs from our donors. So, what we have is a situation where we don't retrieve an organ from a donor unless we have a transplant unit prepared to implant it. Mostly, when they get the organ and they look at it, they go, fine, and they put it in. Sometimes they look at it and they think, I think that's going to be too risky. And so a very small percentage of organs are discarded at the point of before transplantation. Our discard rate is significantly lower than our Spanish colleagues, and we need to be pursuing transplants, not donors.
Mm. Right. Yeah, that's an interesting one to leave us with. The other one here that we touched on just briefly in terms of our day trip to London, remind us never to do that, is the habitually resident, where we have had some evidence that in written submissions that the continuous 6-month period was too short when you take into account certain groups, international students, foreign contractors, all of that sort of stuff. Is there any views on that?
I think a year is
safer.
Yep.
Pardon?
I think a year is safer, to make sure people have time to, find out about the law and be informed. And it would also give us consistency with our colleagues in Wales and potentially Northern Ireland, who are course, looking at their bill next week.
Yes, Professor Brown.
Law Society would endorse that. A year seems a reasonable period of residency.
Okay. Just finish on an area of cost, and again, and from your evidence, I think we've covered a number of areas where there would be a cost, but an outcome of maybe 70 more. Organs available, or people, or donations. But you don't mention the other side of the equation, and I don't know whether there is another side of the equation, and that increased donations will reduce people on dialysis, will reduce the, so how does the committee take this, your evidence, on terms of the issues in and around, proper issues about lack of capacity, whether we'd be able to retrieve another 70, all of that, given the overall figure in Scotland, which was, you know, quite surprising, I suppose, it's, you know, approaching. You know, so what are the other side of the cost here? What are we actually, you know, saving as well? I mean, how does that balance?
You'll only actually save money if you don't put somebody else onto dialysis to replace somebody who was taken off. So you actually have to close down your dialysis units if you're going to actually get cash releasing savings.
Yes. Presumably they're not going on for fun.
They're not going in for fun, but it's the laws of supply and demand are difficult.
It's a health service, I'm afraid.
Indeed. I think the other thing that's, you know, there are obviously choices about investment in all of this process. And if you invest in the things that enable the consent process to change, the authorisation process to change, then you also have choices about whether you also invest in things like the new technologies to perfuse organs, which may give us just as many transplants. So we're in a situation now where transplant surgeons are developing clever boxes that they can put organs into from the point at which they're removed from the body, which effectively replicate the circumstance of the body as closely as possible, and which can improve the functioning of the organ. So one of the things we're looking at is, can you make the untransplantable organ transplantable? So there are a whole range of opportunities that, you know, the funders are faced with, our colleagues in Scottish Government, about what they give us money for. Whether it be changing consent systems, whether it be for new technologies, you know, being able to transplant hearts from people who've died after circulatory death, which we're in the process of evaluating currently. It's about £35,000 just for the organ retrieval in that circumstance, but the outcomes look promising. So there are some choices to be made, and you know,
have you got a figure on what you've proposed? Because you've identified a number of areas that says this will cost us money. You know, the proxy will cost us money. Identifying people will cost us money. The communications program will cost us money. Is there a figure in all of any of that?
Not from NHSBT, but I believe my colleagues in the Scottish Government have done work on that.
All right, we'll ask them then. Lorna Marson.
I mean, I think I suppose I'm privileged in the sense I don't have to worry too much about. I just spend the money. I don't really worry about it. But in a sense, transplantation is one of the most cost-effective treatments for people in the history of the NHS, really. And if you give the example of kidney transplantation, which is the highest number of transplants in terms of single organ, then there is no doubt that after 1 year, a successful transplant is more cost-effective than a year of dialysis, and that benefit continues year on year. And in Northern Ireland, where they have over the last 5 years really been very proactive in their renal transplant program, they have now been able to shut down some dialysis, not units, but time. So the twilight time is the worst time for patients to go on dialysis. So now for 1 or 2 days a week in Belfast, they don't need twilight dialysis slots because they have increased their number of transplants to such an extent that fewer dialysis slots are required. So it is a highly cost-effective treatment. I mean, Sally's point is well made. Where we invest the money to obtain those gains is a question of ongoing debate, and the novel technologies is an interesting area, but it is a highly cost-effective treatment.
Okay. Anne McTaggart.
Thank you. Thank you, and welcome, and I thank again the committee and the members and the witnesses for today's evidence, and also I'll put on record my best wishes and good luck to my Welsh colleagues who start kick-off today, and also for my Northern Ireland. Somebody mentioned that earlier. Yeah, we're slightly ahead in Northern Ireland with this system than what we are here, but really just to say thank you, and I applaud the work that you all do, and I sincerely applaud you all. You're at the front line of it. You're the ones with the most knowledge, experience. I salute you all. The bill itself has came around because we do have to look at, we need to increase our organ donations. We know, and you'll know just as well as I do, there's currently 571 or 72, you can correct me, awaiting an organ transplant today. We aren't... One of the witnesses mentioned earlier about, you know, we do have a great publicity campaign, and yes, we do, and yes, everything that we have done to date has been wonderful, it's been great. However, as the convener mentioned earlier, where do we go from here? This has to step up. We need to do more. We need to be able to do more. We need to save more lives. Three people die daily in the UK. We are all aware of that. We have to do something different, because what we're currently doing is not fit for purpose. In a sense, we're not reaching the targets that we said we would reach. And can I take on, before the convener moves me on, Sally Johnston, you mentioned earlier in your evidence about the increase in donations. So can I have your view on, I have here, there's figures deceased donor rates have fell by 7.5%. The number of deceased donor transplants fell by 13%. And the second quarter figures for this year indicate that there may well be a 16% decrease in deceased donor rates for 2015-16. Could I ask for your views on that?
I'm pleased things have turned around. We had our highest ever donor numbers in October. We had 143 donors across the UK, 365 transplants. That's 26 donors per million population. That's the level that we are aiming to be at every month by 2020. So that suggests to me that we have got some things right in terms of what we're able to do here. As to whether changing legislation will give more impetus to that, I'm not in a position to tell.
Could I supplementary?
No.
On that?
No, go on.
You're right to state the 2020 figures. They are looking at, the Scottish Government has set the target to increase 17.9 per million population in 2012-2013. To 26 per million population by 2020. Mm. Now, you'll be well aware of that figure of what you've just mentioned that we've increased. In the past 3 years, this rate has only increased by 0.3 per million persons. Now, if we're looking for an increase of, 17.9 per million per population, it's only increased in 3 years by 0.3 per million.
We have a new strategy, and part of the thing about strategies is that they don't take off like that, they take off like that. And I think we are beginning to see some of the strategic things that we've put in place begin to bear fruit, whether that be designated requesters, some of the other processes that we've got. And that, I think, is why we had 26 donors per million population for a month last month. There isn't an organ donation system in the world that just steadily increases. Even Spain goes down and back up again, and you just have to keep plugging away at new initiatives to change things and to make sure that everything is done perfectly.
I'm absolutely aware that, we have spoke about it's not the silver bullet, and this isn't the be-all and end-all and will not be 100% increase just with this legislation. However, we have seen from international evidence, and I don't think we can shy away from the international evidence that we have seen. And it's not just a couple of years, you know, that's been going on for 20, 30, 40 years. This evidence, it's not just yesterday's news. I think it was probably you, Ms. Marson, that mentioned it. So do you want to comment on that, about the international evidence?
I don't think the international evidence is clear. In Spain, the opt-out legislation existed far before they saw the increase in organ donor numbers. They then introduced practical, logistical and structural changes to the way organ donation happened, similar to the way that we've done that since 2008. And that is when their organ donor numbers increased. It did not seem to be temporarily related to their legislation Croatia has the second highest donors per million population, and they have an opt-in system. So I don't think that the legislation in isolation is what makes the difference.
I think I would tend to disagree with you there, because the international evidence has clearly indicated that no legislation will be the silver bullet. However, this is a means to getting an increase in organ transplants. And could I also rectify something that I did mention last week, convener, within the committee, and get that on record? It was my mistake and I apologise for that. Last week's evidence, I stated the international evidence, they see a 15 to 20% increase. Please excuse my mistake. It's actually a 25 to 30% increase potentially. So can I just have that on record? And I think my last question will be around some of today's conversations was around, the role of the AIP and where that buck would stop for that decision making. But are you aware that currently the law states that the family cannot legally deny organ removal for transplantation if a deceased was on the organ donor register?
Yes, we are aware, but then you're looking at policy and process and protocol, which is widely and generally recognised that the families are consulted.
And that would not change with this bill?
May the society then respectfully ask, please would you revisit the policy memorandum to try and provide clarity? Because I think all of us have recognised the importance of good communication.
Absolutely.
So any ambiguity at such a difficult time may be problematic.
There is absolutely no way we would want to see any clinicians, any snods, clods, whoever is doing that frontline task, and for that to be any more complicated than it certainly is. Mm. And it wouldn't be changing. Mm-hmm. That role would not be changing. So yes, thank you very much for your word on that, and I will get back to it. My other question was the age of consent. We have here, convener, had changes in the age of consent for various things, including voting. But I take on board what the panel and respect their wishes, so may well look at this. And can I just say from the outset, this bill is not certainly a tablet of stone. It is. I aim for this bill to be workable and for the benefit of all that need it. Mm-hmm. It's not there are possibilities for amendments, there's possibilities. I want to hear what evidence that the committee...
Professor Britton wants to respond.
Ms McTaggart, I think... Again, the idea of consistency at a time, I think my colleagues here said, time is of the essence to try and have a clarity and a consistency of approach. And if other jurisdictions within the UK are going to embark on this path to, again, have the same age limit, is going to promote decision-making at this time.
That can I explain where that evidence, that why that's within the bill, convener? That came through some of the evidence that I had taken whilst I was on the road tripping with the bill and getting some consultation with it. That was young people themselves felt that, well, if they were able to vote now at 16, we're able to do a lot of things at 16, why can't we? And, a lot of them... Just now, there's the age of 12, but yes. With consent with your parents or your guardians. And the point that, and I'm grateful for Rhoda Grant for picking that up, the proxy part of that was there was concern from the Scottish Youth Parliament that young people sometimes don't have a family member, and that leaves them in a difficult position. But also, you'll be well aware that sometimes families don't agree either. Uh-huh. And that was really just given because people wanted the right. And an example of that, we had a person who was filling out our forms for us to give evidence, and they had said, well, I definitely know my husband. I definitely want to donate my organs, but my husband, don't let him decide for me whenever I pass away, because that he'll definitely not allow that to happen. And she didn't want that to be her wishes. So it kind of works both ways. And that's why the proxy aspect was in there, but also the proxy aspect is there because that is in line with the UK government's, the current as a nominated person, I think it's called just now. So it's not any different. It would bring us in line with what the UK currently do.
Any response? We don't need that. It's okay. Thank you very much, Diane McTaggart, and all of our panel here this morning. I found that a very interesting and informative session. Thank you very, very much for your precious time. I hope we can reflect some of your views in our subsequent report. Thank you once again. We suspend. No, we're getting to private session at this time, as previously agreed.